Hello, my name is Tyler Ruff, and here I will be giving a short presentation on the subject of satellite remote sensing of precipitation and its context within global climate change. Precipitation is a physical phenomenon that we are all familiar with, one that has vast influences on life on Earth because it is essential for survival, but too much or too little of it can have enormous impacts. Precipitation is also very sensitive to climatic changes, and indeed throughout Earth's history, the amount of precipitation an area receives is always the biggest determiner of the type of climate that area will harbor. Hence, the ability to accurately measure precipitation is not only vital towards ensuring the health of humans, but global climate change has the potential to change precipitation trends dramatically in the near future. Okay, so let's go a little more into detail on the physics of precipitation and the relationship to future climate change. Precipitation is caused by the uplifting and therefore cooling of air in the atmosphere, either by synoptic weather systems, convection induced by the sun, or by orographic lifting over, for instance, mountains. Once an air parcel cools enough, it will reach its saturation point, where then the water vapor will condense and form clouds. If the right physical conditions are present, these micron-sized water droplets will lump together and form larger droplets, eventually falling out of the cloud as rain or snow, depending on the temperature. Precipitation readily occurs over all of Earth's surface at some point, but it is much more concentrated over regions on Earth where air is prone to rise, namely the tropics and the mid-latitudes. But over these regions, immense variability can occur in the precipitation rate over time, leading to flooding or droughts, as well as other natural disasters. Climatic phenomena, such as El Niño, influence precipitation and temperature trends, but it is difficult to model these changes because they are very complex. In the context of future climate change, the Earth will be warming due to increased greenhouse gases. Due to a relationship between temperature and the water holding capacity of air, warmer temperatures typically imply increased water vapor in the atmosphere, and hence greater chances of large amounts of precipitation to fall at one time. Model predictions show that into the future, we may see more extreme precipitation events. And the increased precipitation amounts are not supposed to be globally uniform, and instead thought that the wet areas may become wetter and the dry areas may become drier in the future. Now, let's put precipitation in the context of remote sensing. Typically, one might think of ground-based radar as a source of most precipitation measurements we regularly use from day to day. These are active sensors, in that they emit an electromagnetic pulse and then measure the reflected radiation. This has a major caveat in that surface radars can only see as far as the curvature of Earth allows them, which is only around a couple hundred kilometers, and that they only cover a limited area of the Earth's surface. Satellites are therefore the main tool to use for measuring global precipitation. There are varying techniques that are used today, but the main method is as follows. A microwave radiometer is used to passively measure microwaves being emitted by the Earth underneath it. Due to the Planck function, which relates an object's emitted radiation to an object's temperature, the sensor effectively measures the differences in temperatures of the object below it. The radiometer can detect the precipitation rate and cloud structures because microwave temperatures are sensitive to liquid and ice hydrometeors. By the way, microwaves are also used because there is a large atmospheric window over this region of the spectrum, allowing for multiple frequencies to be measured and then compared in order to obtain a more accurate result. Over the ocean, rain droplets will appear warm compared to the ocean's surface because the emissivity of the sea is only about one-half in the microwave spectrum, effectively making it look cold relative to its actual temperature. Over land, it is more complicated since surface emissivities are typically high, but high-frequency microwaves are greatly scattered by ice crystals and clouds, typically indicating precipitation, and therefore, a microwave signal will appear colder than the relatively warm signal of the land around it. The microwave radiometer must use a polar orbiting track in order to ensure a high enough resolution, because a caveat of using microwaves is that their long wavelength decreases the theoretical limit to the spatial resolution, and therefore the satellite must orbit lower to achieve adequate resolutions. The obvious problem with using a polar orbit is that there is a very poor temporal resolution, at least relative to the quickly changing nature of the precipitation below it. There also can be gaps in the coverage. The way around this is to use geostationary satellites to fill in the missing data. These satellites measure frequencies in the infrared spectrum, which are relatively transparent to water vapor, which then allows it to measure temperatures of the Earth below it. Using algorithms that relate cloud top temperature to precipitation rates, the temperature data are converted to precipitation data. Via complicated means of statistical integration, the microwave and infrared data can be merged together to form global coverage at consistent time intervals. Now, let's look at some actual data. Here is an animation showing a typical final product produced by TRIM, or the Tropical Rainfall Measuring Mission, which is one of the major initiatives on global precipitation measurement at the NASA Goddard Space Flight Center, which started getting funding about a decade ago. This is showing week-long precipitation accumulation from the 23rd of October to the 30th of October in 2008. Here are two example images for the 29th of October 2008, one for the CMORF infrared and microwave blending method, and another for the Persian neural network infrared interpolation method. These techniques are both using relatively the same data from the TRIM satellite and the major geostationary weather satellites, but the algorithms used to convert the data into actual precipitation units are obviously quite different. Satellite precipitation measurement is a relatively recent undertaking, but major improvements have been made in the science and methods behind it. Increasingly, satellites like these are providing more accurate, high-resolution data that are extremely valuable for the public, as well as for the scientific community. In conclusion, while satellites may never replace ground-based radar for short-term weather forecasting, the need for seamless global precipitation data sets will become ever more important as climate change modifies precipitation trends in the future. Thank you.